answer was Mel Brooks, Terry Gross, and a couple of others. Very good. It gives me great pleasure to welcome Paul Barnes to the stage. Did any of you hear the impromptu on WFMT yesterday?
Yes.
Great. I was there. It was very exciting. And we're going to get more tonight. And he brought 7 different CDs that you can acquire and that he will sign for you. So let's welcome Paul Barnes, if he's ready. I think he's ready. He's coming on. Paul Barnes.
It's wonderful to be in Chicago. Most of you know the real reason I'm here is to visit my daughter, Hannah. And I'm so glad you could come with all of your friends as well, too. But I also had a new CD that came out, and so I'm going to be playing several pieces from that CD for you. I'll be signing them afterwards out the back if you're interested. I'm starting off, how many of you heard the radio program yesterday? I was so thrilled. You know, Lisa Flynn is such a wonderful interview, and it was such a wonderful space, and had a wonderful audience and things like that. But I didn't have time to play this little trilogy of etudes that I normally play, so I do have time now. So I'm going to play all 3 of the etudes. It's kind of I organize things in a kind of a sonata way, so it's a fast, slow, fast set of etudes. The first one features repeated notes. And repeated notes used very expressively repeated chords and repeated octaves. So that's kind of a traditional approach to the etude, which is a study on piano technique. The middle piece is a very beautiful, like a slow movement, beautiful lyrical study with embedded counterpoint and some really interesting things going on rhythmically where he changes the middle section into 7/8, etc. And the final one is I call it Philip's homage to Beethoven. So raise your hand if you've played a Beethoven piano sonata before. Many of you, excellent. Okay, your task, and perhaps you'll get free tickets if you answer this right too, is to figure out which sonatas are referenced in the etude number 11. There are 3, okay? Some of the references are rather cryptic, okay, so I don't expect you to get all of them. Anyway, this is Philip Glass etude 6, 8, and 11.
Thank you.
name of the CD. It's called New Generations. I don't know if it's anywhere in the stuff. That's the whole, it's right on the front there, of course. And the reason I got the title was because of this next piece. It was written by, at the time, Jonah Gallagher, who was 21 years old. And I'd never played a piece by anyone that young. And so I said, well, what a great idea to use young people. And so the cover of the CD, which you'll see when you buy it afterwards, is the cover shot was taken by my son, Peter, who is a beginning photographer. And I still remember he comes over and says, Dad, get a chair, follow me. And that's all he said. And for those of you that haven't seen the photo, it's, well, you'll see it afterward. And so I take my chair and he takes me, we live right next to a lake in a big field, so he plops me down right in the middle of the field and shoots a shot of me sitting in a field. And we sent, and then we took, of course, the traditional kind of urban hip shots in downtown Lincoln. We sent them both into New York and they went gaga over the field. They just loved it. So that's the one that actually ended up making making the cover. And Peter at the time was only 18, and I like the idea of using young people, creative young people, to do really good things. So, in any event, the next piece is Ad Infinitum. For those of you that are familiar with the additive structures of like John Adams or Steve Reich, that's basically the idea behind Jonah's piece. You'll see various different patterns that are shaped beautifully harmonically, but in varying ways. So this is Jonah Gallagher's Ad Infinitum.
Thank you.
The next work is by a very, very dear friend of mine, Ivan Moody. He's written several works for me. He is an English composer. He is an Orthodox priest who serves a parish in Portugal, so he gets around. And he most recently wrote a piano quintet for me based on the Greek Orthodox hymns for the resurrection of Christ, Christos Anesti. While he was in the hospital recovering from an illness, he decided out of the blue to write a piece for me. So I didn't commission this or whatever, but it's such a beautiful piece. But it's a very, very different piece in so many ways. It's about 11 minutes long. And what I think, you know, and of course the Italian word fioriture means blooming. And it's this idea that spring comes and life absolutely comes forth. And it's really about life. But for him and also for me, the connection of life and love is so profound. So that when I described the piece to him and he seemed to like it, I said, this is like a, it's like a love affair with the note F. And because it just starts out with that single F. And it's almost like the creative qualities in love, where it expands and comes back in, and then expands into ever-increasing brightness. It's very much like you would imagine the creation of the world. And because of this element of love that's communicated musically, there's this idea of, for me, there's an idea of divine presence, where you're not in a hurry, you're simply in the presence of divine love, and what else do you need out of life? So this is Ivan Moody's Fioriture.
Thank you.
can see, I have really talented friends. It's a real joy. I'd like to play another Philip Glass etude. This is number 16. It's a beautiful study for those of you that love Debussy, like I do. Debussy has this ability, it really revolutionized the way that we understand musical texture, where he would have these elements of music in various registers functioning almost independently from each other. And the when it mixed together, it created this miracle, this sonic miracle that we had never heard before. And what Glass does with Etude 16 is a type of musical layering. So you'll hear many different layers, all of which come in and kind of work independently of each other. This is the Etude number 16.
Thank you.
last work on tonight's program was also written for me by a very, very good friend of mine, Ann Lincoln Haynes, who teaches at Pepperdine University. We went to Indiana University together. And he wrote this piece. Philip Glass has actually written several works, the Orpheus, you know, opera, many works that are inspired by Jean Cocteau, you know, the playwright and artist, and he coined this term called monstre sacré, which means basically holy terror. And it was his way of describing those artistic types that we absolutely must have their art, and because we must have their art, we're willing to put up with so much crap and so much issues in terms of things. We're very forgiving. This is the monstre sacré. Now, the one thing that Lincoln made very clear when he was writing this piece for me was that it wasn't about me. It was for me. And so it's a fascinating excursion into the many facets of this holy terror. So the first, if you're a music student, raise your hand. I know we have some music students, good. So you know you're studying your music history and you know all about the French overture, okay? The first movement is written in the style of a pompous French overture. It is the entrance of the monster at a party usually. And so we're having these very overblown double chords, big dotted double chords. And it's actually followed by a 6-8 G, which is exactly what you would expect in the French overture style. The second movement kind of answers the musical question, what would happen if Glenn Gould showed up at your party, which would never happen, of course. But let's say he did, and you convinced him to sit down and improvise on themes of Bach. The second movement just might be the result. The third movement is the cherished slow movement. What was interesting when Lincoln wrote it was that he wanted to use these musical palindromes to communicate the idea that the monster, he or she, is looking in a mirror, you know, and so we have these mirror images reflected musically and falling in love with what he or she sees. So that's the beautiful slow second movement. And then the final movement is the dance and final exit. So we have this very funky dance that, and again, big, brilliant, brilliant piano writing. And then what you'll hear at the very end is the return of the pompous chords and the monster exits. So this is Emily and Hen's Monstre Sacré. my favorite transcriptions. I played this on the radio yesterday. It's my transcription from Orfeu and the Princess. And I told a very important story about the love progression. It's has aphrodisiac qualities. So you do need to be careful who you're looking at the moment it comes in for the very first time. This is a piece that Philip Glass wrote. He wrote the opera after his wife had died. And every time that that chord progression comes in the opera, it's a story of tragic love where it's always sacrificial. So the lover sacrifices him or herself for the beloved. So this is Orfeu and the Princess.
This is the
very, very first transcription I ever did. It's kind of high energy. This is the dance from Akhenaten. Does anybody know what Akhenaten was famous for? Introducing a crazy idea he introduced to the Egyptian people. Yes!
Monotheism!
Monotheism! Very good. Didn't go over very well. But that is, and this is a scene in the opera where they are celebrating, it's actually a ballet, and they're celebrating the one true sun god, Aten. This is the dance from Akhenaten.